Welcome you to Dowdy-Ficklin Stadium in Greenville, North Carolina. Conference play in the American. ECU at 1-4 welcomes in Temple at 2-3 with the Owls in search of their first conference win. Mike Cousins, John Congemi, so glad that you could be here with us as this ECU crowd looks for win number two of the year as they prepare for the Pirates to take the field. While the numbers have not been great for the Pirates this year, they have gotten life from their quarterback, John.
Because of his experience coming over from Duke, Thomas Cirque has done a nice job of protecting the football, and he's added to his running totals, 2 touchdowns last week. I think if Temple wants to pressure the pocket today, come after Thomas Cirque, he's going to find some big plays in the passing game behind the Owls secondary.
And Temple's rushing game last week saw a big surge in the second half, despite negative yardage in the first, 150 in the second half against Houston, and they'll look to replicate that here today. ECU winners of the coin toss, and they defer. So Temple will start the game on offense here, trying to snap a two-game losing streak. They're 2-3, 0-2 in the American, with losses against USF and last week at home against Houston. And their redshirt sophomore quarterback, Logan Marshy, is going to try and play on 2 feet this week, a lot more than he did last week.
Yes, have some balance in the pocket, be able to step into throws. 3 interceptions last week, 2 really weren't on Marshy, a tip ball and a Hail Mary. But you're right, Temple, as you said in the open, they need to build on that running game, stay on the field and make some first downs.
So they spread the field out on first down, and David Hood gets the carry at running back. So we saw David Hood a bit last week against Houston. Now the normal starting running back for the Owls is Raquel Armstead. We were told he'd be a game time decision, and it looks like that decision was to stay on the sideline. Hood turns it to the outside and across the 35 out near the 40-yard line, a first down for Temple.
The biggest challenge for the Pirates defensively is being able to tackle in space. If they don't do that better, they're going to be on the field for a long time because Temple will be able to run and throw the football. Nice bounce outside by Hood on that second down run.
Similar look again after a pickup of 13, and Marshy looks to go to the air for the first time today. And a sliding attempt by Isaiah Wright gets it across midfield. Another Temple first down. Jeff Collins very optimistic about his group, taking over for Matt Rhule, who went to Baylor, a former defensive coordinator who spent time in the SEC. And the one thing that he pointed out specifically about their run game, which they're hoping to get going here today, and they get a gain of 4 on first down, was having his offensive coordinator, Dave Patmude, up in the booth. Started last week against Houston, doing it again this week here in North Carolina, which was something that Patmude hadn't done in about 8 years, they said.
Well, when he shared that information with us last week and then yesterday, he can trust his own eyes up in the booth. That's what Patmude really likes to do. It's a lot easier to see the running lanes, the passes, the ball distribution from up in the booth.
Keith Kirkwood makes the catch, and it's another Temple first down. Gain of 13.
He gets good information, I believe, up in the box. And that's the biggest thing for Patmude being the offensive coordinator, trusting his eyes and getting the football spread out to the athletes, which Temple has a bunch of them. They haven't had a negative play so far. They've been outside in the running game and a good pass play on the last play.
Now it is Armstead into the game who plunges forward and picks up 3 yards.
I believe Armstead is going to be in a situation today, Mike. He's going to give you what he has. If it's 10 plays, if it's 12 plays, it may be 20. But give you what you can do on the field. He didn't practice all week. He was a game-time decision, as you mentioned. He's been banged up, really, for 3 or 4 weeks. So this is a running back that's just going to add to the offense on the ground.
Marshy to pass on 2nd and 7. Good pocket, one-on-one, down the sideline. And incomplete, intended for Ventel Bryant. Dave Patnood said they're going to make a concerted effort to get him the ball a lot more this week after they haven't done that as much as they'd like in previous games.
Sargent in coverage for the Pirates defensively, but you're right. Isaiah Wright was the focus last week at home against Houston. Today, we might see Bryant attract the football much more, maybe even appear in the backfield. Big third down opportunity for Temple.
First one of the drive, and Marshy goes to the sideline, smothering coverage on top of Kirkwood. Another Temple first down.
Good strong catch on the outside.
Offense, number 84, 5-yard penalty, third down. Blair Fielder was the catch.
Looks like that flag's going to bring that conversion back.
And it's still third down.
And make it third and long for the Owls. That was a good pitch and catch on the outside. I know Jeff Collins upset about the penalty, but likes the execution, needs it again here to at least get into field goal range here on third and 13.
Second straight week where a nice catch that helped move the chains from Kirkwood has been wiped away. Last week it was on a review, this week a penalty. Third down, 13, and Marshy wants it all up top and threw it too long, looking for Kirkwood again.
And Kirkwood had a step to the middle of the field, beat the free safety that was about 5 yards below the depth of the route. So the Pirates find a way on a penalty, aided by a penalty, to get off the field and force a very long field goal opportunity.
So it's Marshy, the quarterback, to hold for Aaron Bumeri, a 52-yard try. Now he's got it from straight away, and a spinning kick is no good. Off to the left, and the opening drive set back by a penalty, and Temple, which moved with efficiency, comes away scoreless. Welcome back to the American Athletic Conference on ESPN. Mike Cousins, John Congemi with you here at the home of the ECU Pirates, Dowdy Ficklin Stadium. Logan Marshy and the Temple Owls with no points, a missed field goal on their opening drive. In game number 18 as the head coach for Scotty Montgomery. Here at East Carolina, former Duke offensive coordinator, NFL wide receiver, and his team starts on the ground. Darius Hinnix, the freshman from Elon, North Carolina, who showed himself to be a one-man wrecking crew on a handful of plays last week, is going to see a lot more action today.
He will get hopefully 20 touches if things go right for the Pirates on offense today.
Hand off coming around the outside of the formation. Two straight rushes. That was Davon Grayson with just his third carry of the year. The team's leading wide receiver gets 11 yards.
Two runs outside on the edge against the Temple defense. They have to do a better job of setting that edge, getting upfield with those defensive ends and linebackers.
Cirque with the empty backfield. Steps up in the face of pressure, completes the pass for a first down, and then some. Jimmy Williams still going, and he's inside the 30-yard line. Explosive play, 20 yards for the senior for ECU.
And the tempo that East Carolina is going to run this offense with, they're going to try to get the football outside to their athletes. Jimmy Williams, just a simple dig route to the inside, a positive play on the third offensive play of the game.
What a great setup for Pinnix. They set him up outside, throw it to him, and then let him run and move people out of the way.
I think with tempo and the athletes that East Carolina has on offense, they're going to be able to dictate the pace of this game to the Temple defense.
Hand off Pinnix, who's got a head of steam, turning around the corner and shoulders his way right through Delvon Randall out of bounds. That's the type of play they hope to get for four quarters from Pinnix.
The freshman Pinnix loves to finish runs. You will see him lower his shoulder, lower his pad level, and deliver the blow to the defender.
Sirk, the quarterback, also a running threat himself. And there he goes inside the 10-yard line and tripped up down to the 6.
When the Pirates get into the red zone in short yardage situations, look for Thomas Sirk, who had 2 touchdowns last week against USF, to be able to run the football. That'll put an added stress on this defense.
Every play on this drive has been at least 5 yards for ECU. Sirk, and he runs out of room, swallowed up by 3 white jerseys on the perimeter.
And Mike, finally, the Temple defense gets up the field on the edge of the defense to force a runner. This time, Thomas Sirk back to where all the white jerseys are. That was a really good job by Finch on the outside, and he had help from the linebacking corps.
Third down and 2. Sirk gets hit from behind and then tripped up. So not enough for the first down there for ECU. Both teams getting close and good looks at the end zone on their opening drive, and they'll both have to settle for field goal attempts.
Yeah, you said the player from behind was Taylor. It looked like Julian Taylor came from that tackle spot, and he ran right into Sean Bradley, number 23, in the middle, the linebacker. So Sirk trying to run on back-to-back plays. Temple up to the challenge, and that'll force the field goal opportunity for the Pirates.
This is a try from 28. For the sophomore, Jake Verity, rather 25. He was good from 28 last week and good from 25 here today.
ESPN College Football is presented by Vizio, maker of award-winning 4K displays, and in part by Degree Deodorant. It won't let you down.
It's not exactly what you call football weather just yet. Not too chilly here in Greenville, North Carolina. Warm day as the Pirates lead 3-0 after their opening drive stalled, but they thought they maybe should have had a few more yards.
A couple guys that looked like had the face mask of quarterback Thomas Sirk. It was Taylor first and then Bradley, 23, that's going to get his left hand around the face gear. That does look like a grab right there, and Sirk was right. He probably could have drawn the penalty and had possession of the football going in for a touchdown instead of settling for a field goal.
Jake Verity capped it off from 25 yards out. Each team on its opening drive moved the ball really well and then met resistance. Neither of them faced a third down until the 8th play of their respective drives.
And that's a good sign, especially for the Temple Owls, because they're the team that needs to score against a defense that has been giving up yards and points with regularity week in and week out.
Caleb Pratt's kick goes out of the end zone for a touchback. Temple will take over first.
Coming up tonight, it's the Paul Bunyan Trophy on the line at the Big House in Ann Arbor, Michigan State, and number 7, Michigan. How about a former American Conference quarterback taking center stage for the Wolverines? John O'Korn, the former Houston Cougar, takes over for Wilton Spate, who's injured and will be out for a few weeks there. That game, 7:30 on ABC, also available live on the ESPN app.
Yeah, the big story is O'Korn, but that defense of Michigan, first in the Big Ten in total yards, led by these two guys, Devin Bush, a South Florida native like John O'Korn, who played at St. Thomas Aquinas High School.
David Hood takes the handoff from Marshy on first down. A commitment to the running game for Temple. They'll do it out of a lot of different formations. And it's going to be a little bit of a different look than it has been over, let's say, the first 3 weeks here compared to the last 2 for the Owls and the way they run the ball.
They want to spread you out and then take advantage of those running lanes that are built by formations.
Hood's got the 30 and then tripped up by Bobby Fulp, the safety.
Jake Robinson, the tight end, a nice block out in front of David Hood. Good gain on second down, but this is the money down. This is where Temple needs to convert on third down. They have to find a way, Mike, to stay on the football field, keep this offense with pressure against this Pirate defense that is giving up chunks of yards and points.
Marshy on the pitch and a stretch toward the 35-yard line for Hood.
Well, what a good effort by both runner and linebacker. Ramseur, Aaron Ramseur, the linebacker for the Pirates, comes over with quickness, 51 in black. He's going to try to stop David Hood, but it looks like Hood reached that football out, touches the 35. That's going to be a first down.
So they've got it first and 10 now at the 35-yard line. The Temple offense has really struggled to put points on the board. 120, you're talking bottom 10, bottom 15 teams in the country in all those offensive categories.
Well, Mike, this Temple offense, they're going to need to get into the 20s, I believe, today to have a chance to win this game. They have to have that offensive explosion, and they're hoping that they're poised to do it behind Logan Marshy in the passing game. But the running game has been very good. Last week, remember, the second half of the game, they ran it very well against Houston and continues today on the road.
Marshy, with all sorts of time, had his feet set and throws for his tight end, Kenny Yeboah. There's a late flag along the sideline as well as Yeboah goes down.
Yeah, Bobby Fulp, the strong safety, came over.
After play, personal foul, defense, number 8, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
No need for Bobby Fulp to continue this tackle on the Pirates sideline. It's a good throw and catch on time by Marshy. Finds his big target outside the numbers, and there's no need for this. Just lay off. You don't have to take him to the ground. He takes the big tight end to the ground. It's going to cost him 15.
Plus the 6 on the catch, so a total gain of 21 yards on that catch by Yeboah. This Isaiah Wright getting his first action of the day from Marshy for a couple.
I like what Temple's doing. They're mixing in that outside run. They're getting the football out of the pocket with quickness. Offensive line holding up so far, but they have to find those playmakers for those explosive plays. This is tough to do when you go 10 yards, 12 yards, 10 yards without a mistake.
Ball comes loose. Armstead fell on top of it. So Temple keeps possession. But, John, you know, we go back to what Logan Marshy told us about yesterday in what he had seen on film from the ECU defense. He said they'll rush 4, they'll rush 5. We can stop that. And then the zone coverage is usually soft. I like the short throw.
Take what's there, and it's on the outside of the Pirates' defense. It's with your playmakers. It's Isaiah Wright. It's Jennings. It's Bryant on the outside. It's the running game so far of David Hood that's giving this offense balance. They need to find a way to convert on third down. It looks like they're going to talk about it.
Timeout.
Before the snap.
This will be a 30-second timeout.
Temple on the move, looking to get on the scoreboard, and we're coming right back to ECU.
It's streaming live on the ESPN app. Download now and take ESPN everywhere.
Temple took a timeout. They've got 3rd and 8 at the ECU 38-yard line. Marshy, short throw and a stiff arm and then some more. First down Temple. Isaiah Wright, his second catch on the drive. And there are 2 flags late along the sideline. That has been a dangerous zone for both teams in this quarter.
That might be the second one on Bobby Fulp coming over late. I don't know if he made contact, but he definitely, it looked like verbally, may have drawn the flag.
After play, unsportsmanlike conduct, defense, number 8, the penalty happens to go, automatic first down. This is the first unsportsmanlike foul for number 8 in the game.
What is he doing?
He's not playing very smart football, and I'm sure head coach Scotty Montgomery is not going to like this. I'm not sure if it's the contact right there. I think it's what he says afterwards. No, it might have been the headbutt at the end that gets the flag. That's just not... It's not good football. It's not a smart play when you're giving free yardage to a team that's moving the football very effectively without it. Again, spread formation by Temple. Look for the running of David Hood.
1st and 10 at the 12. Margie goes inside the 10-yard line. Ventel Bryant carries Chris Love out of bounds.
This is where the area of the field, they have to be able to put it in the end zone. They settled for a long field goal the first time down. Red zone efficiency, not very good for the Temple Owls. Last weekend, they had first and goal, I believe, from inside the 10. They ended up punting the football.
Marshy's got time going toward the sideline. This is where they ran into trouble last week. And he throws to the end zone and has it intercepted. Now ECU's coming back with it. Aaron Ramsour, the freshman from Shelby, North Carolina, turns the tables on the quarterback for Temple. So, John, you mentioned a punt in the red zone. How does that happen? First and goal. He ran backwards last week, and he did it again this week.
Well, evidently, Logan did not learn from his mistakes from last week. The ball should be gone right now into the stands. Throw it away. There's only bad things that can happen to you when you throw it late and you throw it across your body. And that's a good job by Ramsour getting in the passing lane. But this ball should be in the end zone, over the end zone, and thrown into the stands so Temple can come back and still have a scoring opportunity. Terrible decision that time by Logan, and he probably the first one that wants that one back.
Sets up first down from the 33-yard line. Sirk's got plenty of time and a man wide open along the sideline. Blown coverage as Quay Johnson is the receiver, and he takes it down to the 36 for ECU. Major pickup of 31 yards.
And Mike, it's easy to move the football when you get explosive plays in a drive. Sudden change opportunity, pump fake to the outside. Sirks goes to one of his playmakers in Quay Johnson. That's just a huge gain on first down.
To the air again. Jimmy Williams was the motion man, and he makes the catch. And he goes down, and there's another sideline flag.
They're going to call this on Sam Franklin, the linebacker, who's not in the football game for Temple.
There's no foul for a late hit out of bounds. Second down.
I'm not so sure that Sam Franklin wasn't trying to hold him up and he slipped. Remember, it rained before the game. Let's take another look at this. Williams is going outside. They wave off the penalty, but I'm not so sure if that's his shoulder or that he's trying to help him up.
I think he may have just slipped.
I think it's a combination of both.
I mean, it did rain, that's right, and it is sticky today. So there's definitely some mugginess to the air. Pinnix looking to find a hole off to the right side. And it'll be third down coming up for ECU. So Pinnix was recruited at first as a linebacker. That's what they were going to bring him in as. He said, you know what? I want to play running back. And in order to keep his commitment, he said, all right.
Well, he plays running back like a linebacker. He wants to deliver the hits.
Third down for Sirk. Throwing past the sticks. Tipped and out of bounds. Incomplete. Looking for Jimmy Williams. Good coverage from Linwood Crump. A little bit more hang time. It might have been back-to-back interceptions after that tip ball.
And a lot of hand fighting between Crump and Jimmy Williams, the receiver for the Pirates. Hand on the shoulder. He's just looking. A little tug on the shoulder pad. I think Crump got away with one on third down.
So fourth and six and a field goal try here for the Pirates from 50 yards. Verity's got the leg to it, but it's no good off well to the right. He's got power in that leg. He kicked a 63-yarder in high school, but not accurate from 50. So it's still 3-0 ECU. The ESPN app is a fan's best friend. You can stream every ESPN and ABC college football game live at home or on the go. You'll get access to scores, news, and highlights all season long. Download the ESPN app to start streaming now.
Might try to catch the end of that Florida State-Miami game later today.
You leave Greenville. It's a 90-minute drive back to the Raleigh-Durham airport. And I know with your chauffeur, you'll be able to watch the game right off your phone.
I should be able to put my feet up in the back seat. That's correct.
With the jacuzzi in the back of your limousine, yeah.
Should have a drink with an umbrella in it, I'm hoping.
Second charge, timeout, Temple.
Second timeout for Temple. A drive of redemption for Collins and Marshall. A field goal is the difference between ECU and Temple as the Owls take over here with a minute 43 left in the first quarter. Looking for their first conference win of the year. Scotty Montgomery, the Pirates head coach, having a very emphatic conversation with their referee, Todd LaPenta, during the timeout.
Animated on the sidelines, and he has reason to. There's been a couple questionable calls early in this game that haven't gone his way, but Temple's going to take the football back at their own 33-yard line.
Marshy from the gun, and the handoff goes to Rob Ritrovato, one of two fullbacks listed on the depth chart. Guy who's a former walk-on, came in as a linebacker, and he's got the nickname Nitro.
We're seeing a lot of that former linebacker running back today on both sides of the football. Ritrovato, one of those guys in between the tackles Temple's going to look to for yards today.
Ritrovato got four on first down. Now Marshy goes over the top. Not a great throw. Bobby Fulp in the area on the pass intended for Broderick Yancey.
And that's a very difficult pass to complete when you have a safety on either hash. You have to have one of those seam routes bending to the middle away from Fulp or away from Wiggins to get them off the hash. That's a tough throw over the linebacker and in front of the safety.
Four-man rush from ECU. Marshy slings it downfield right into the hands of Yancey, who takes it inside the 20-yard line. Had him running right up the middle of the field, and Marshy delivers. Temple with a big chunk, 48 yards.
And, Mike, that's the best throw of the game. That was right on the money with perfect timing. Marshy led Yancey, and I don't think Yancey was expecting the football. This isn't bad coverage, but anticipating the throw down the middle, that's just a perfect throw. He threw it into the lap of Broderick Yancey.
Ritrovato, the fullback, still in, and he plows through the middle to gain a nice chunk on first down. Some change of pace runners for Temple, whether it's been David Hood, Rob Ritrovato. And this has only been the first quarter. Last week we saw some running back carries or to go into wide receivers.
And they're going to have to do it without Armstead. You know, he had a couple carries early, but he's the running back that's banged up, so it's going to be running by committee for Marshy and company.
What time is it? Well, I have no idea based off of those timepieces, but they do look great. However, the Temple offense, looking great, has yet to get any points on the board. 141 yards in the first quarter. 9 first downs, but nothing to show for it. And Logan Marshy in the first quarter got into the red zone, was picked off by Aaron Ramsewer.
And on the other side, ECU threw their first shutout in the first quarter this year defensively.
So Marshy throwing, going to the end zone, a diving try for Adonis Jennings. Incomplete. This is an ECU defense. That's a very important number, John, because they give up 51 points a game.
And they should have given up a touchdown here. Marshy had exactly what he wanted after play action. Down the barrel, down the middle of the field. Good timing. I know you're thinking Jennings may have come up with that catch, but if you put it on his body, on his frame, it's an easy touchdown for Temple.
They can still get another first down, 3rd and 6. Marshy moving back, throwing deep.
Kenny Yeboah was there. Corinne Wiggins, the safety, trying to take it away. So fourth and six.
That was a good play by Wiggins coming from the free safety spot. Marcy's going to buy some time by retreating from the line of scrimmage, getting further away from that pocket. I think the ball almost goes through the hands or the arms of Wiggins. May have thrown Yeboah off a little bit, crossing in the deep end of that end zone.
Much easier try on a field goal here for Brumary, who missed from 52 earlier. This one from 29. And he puts it up, and this time splits the uprights. Tie game at three.
ECU 3, Temple 3.
Temple looking for its first conference win of the season in three tries. Meanwhile, at the opposite end of the spectrum in the American Conference, you've got three teams that have yet to lose. USF is off this week. You've got Cincinnati coming up next weekend. UCF tonight, ESPNU 8 Eastern, after a big win against Memphis. And Navy leading FBS in rushing yards, hosts Air Force at 3:30. So UConn still winless in conference play, as is Temple, and Cincinnati gets its shot tonight against UCF, which is into the top 25 for the first time since 2013. Just a handful of games for them because of the storms in Florida, but they've got something going there.
Between South Florida and UCF, two very good football teams, well-coached football teams, and they're starting to dominate the AAC.
Chris Love on the kickoff decides not to take it out. So first and 10, 25-yard line coming up for ECU. Later today, a couple big games for you on ESPN 3:30. Number 13 of Miami trying to snap a seven-game losing streak against Florida State. And then over to College Station, number one Alabama against 4-1 Texas A&M, which is riding high right now on its own four-game winning streak, meeting the best team in the country.
That's right. Florida State Jimbo Fisher, the head coach, has never lost to Miami. And Texas A&M, who could forget the incredible loss week one, but they've strung four together, beating Arkansas and South Carolina over the past 2 weeks.
Thomas Cirk, the former Duke quarterback, gets set to go here for ECU. And a long toss to the edge for Hassan Howe, the running back from Jacksonville, Florida. So Darrell Scott, the leading rusher among running backs for ECU, tweaked his groin this week in practice. Not likely to see him today. A heavier load, certainly, of Penix and Hassan Howe, with 28 carries coming into the game for him. Howe touches on second down and three.
Well, this is a quarterback rundown for Thomas Cirk and the Pirates on offense. Darius Penix coming back into the football game. You've got a big tight end in Baguette in the game. This is a follow by the quarterback. It should go off right tackle.
Trying to plunge forward through the middle, trying to get to the 35-yard line for Cirk.
I'm not so sure he got there. It's going to be very close. I think he got to the 34, but didn't touch the 35.
Chains aren't moving.
Neither is the offense. They're staying out on the football field. Fourth and a short one.
All right, bold move here for ECU on its own 34-yard line. Pressure, and it looks like Temple jumps, so Cirk takes a shot downfield, and he comes up with a catch. Jimmy Williams, whoa!
Offside, defense, number 22. The penalty's declined. Most of the play is the first down.
Well, here's your replay on a free play for quarterback Thomas Cirk. He knows he's able to use his snap count to get Russell to jump. So he goes to his playmaker, one-on-one on the outside, going up against Ariel Foster is Jimmy Williams. Perfect throw, good concentration catch and another explosive play for the Pirates on offense.
39-yard catch gives them first and 10 of the 27-yard line. Sirk wants the sideline again, and Quay Johnson had it in his hands. Let's go to the studio quickly and check in with Chris Cotter.
All right, guys, Auburn's offense is really starting to percolate here over the last couple of games. Jared Stidham here finding Darius Slayton in the end zone. Heck of a catch by Slayton in the back corner over on the SEC Network. It's all War Eagle right now.
All right, after the incomplete pass on first down, Al makes the catch on the perimeter from Sirk.
Chandler on the stop, the Owls gain of 7 on the play, third down and 3, ball at the Temple 20-yard line.
So ECU showing off its explosiveness through the air. Top 15 passing offense. Sirk gives it up, the ball comes loose, quickly picked up by Howe, and he's only going to go backwards after that, but there is a flag potentially holding on the play.
Flag on the play.
Two flags down, one comes at the line of scrimmage, and the other is down around the 13, 14-yard line.
Well, the first white jersey I saw, I believe, was Foster coming in. It looked like he was the Owl defender that was held on the outside by one of the Pirate wide receivers.
Holding offense, number 81. The penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Now holding call against ECU wide receiver Jimmy Williams.
Great recognition. I'm not so sure why Temple may have not decided to take this penalty and make it a longer third down opportunity and at least get him outside of a field goal chance here from 45 yards.
So now it sets up Jake Verity with the ball at the 27-yard line.
The way on the field of a catch is in the further view. A pitch of timeout.
As it stands now, it'll be a 44-yard field goal try for ECU.
It was going to be the quick screen to the outside. The hold's outside on Williams, 81. The ball is bobbled. Hits the ground, so it's an incomplete.
I don't believe he ever had control of the football.
No. Ball's there. I'm not so sure he made an act. The ball hits the ground, so it should have been an incompletion on the pass.
Right.
He got on the football like it was a fumble, but I think it was an incomplete pass. So the ball's going to be, the field goal attempt's going to go from 44 yards. And the official's trying to go back and maybe take a look at where to spot the football correctly and if it was a catch or not. Ruling on the field was an incomplete pass, which I believe it should have been.
Well, for as well as these offenses have moved, the thing that's hampered them most has been flags so far.
Flags, and when they get close to the red zone, they're getting in scoring opportunities. They're going backwards. They're negative plays, holding penalties, procedural penalties, a lot of things that teams, when you're not winning with consistency, happen a lot.
We should go back and revisit quickly here before we get the call, though. That play where it was an offsides call on Chappelle Russell, the linebacker for Temple, and what Thomas Sirk did in that moment.
After further review, it was not a catch. It was an incomplete pass. The ball will be placed back at the 20-yard line. It'll be third down. Temple will accept the penalty for holding, 10-yard penalty. Please set the game clock to 12 minutes and 22 seconds. 12 minutes and 22 seconds, please. Thank you.
So that should
And
make
I'll have
it.
A small fry on the end of that order.
Yeah, exactly. I'll double that with you. But it should be third down now with the ball on the 30-yard line for the Pirates offense.
So they're going to re-coordinate here, but that long play from Cirque, that's the type of play that you get out of a guy who's a grad transfer. Tony Peterson, the offensive coordinator, he said, Cirque is the type of guy you wish all your freshmen would show up already being that way, already well-tuned, already knowing exactly where to go and when to go there.
Like a guy he had at Marshall and Chad Pennington.
Now he's got to find where to go on third and 13. Real pressure, and he goes down back at the 37-yard line.
Late flag as well, Mike.
Finch on the tackle. Line on the play.
Finch in with the sack, but did he get a face mask? It was a very late penalty coming in. May have been a hold as well in the backfield. Three Temple Owls around quarterback Thomas Cirque.
Personal foul, face mask, offense, number 78. Penalty is declined, fourth down.
Left tackle, Messiah Rice.
Got the face mask, but it was on the offense. Left tackle, Rice, he's going to get that left hand around the headgear, around the face mask. The officials see it, but three Temple Owls in the backfield, finished off by Finch. Terrific job by getting pressure, creating pressure, and making Thomas Cirque move off of his spot on third down.
And an injured Temple player is the linebacker, Sam Franklin.
Number 36, Sam Franklin.
The sophomore from Florida. So it's all the way back at the 37-yard line here for ECU, fourth down and 20.
Mike, a lot of rinse and repeat once offenses cross the 30 or 25-yard line. It seems like penalties and mistakes get them into either a long field goal opportunity or a punting situation.
There's been an end zone force field so far here in the early going. Austin Barnes sends it into the sky, and it takes a bounce down inside the 10 for Temple. So a long field for the Owls. They try and break a 3-3 deadlock at Dowdy-Ficklin Stadium. Back here in North Carolina, Temple and ECU tied at 3. Mike Cousins along with John Congemi with 11:46 left here in the second. Let's take a look at today's backstage pass, which brings us to right before kickoff. This is the Pirate who leads ECU out onto the field. That is also known as the John Congemi workout plan. Get ripped and then rip your shirt.
Yeah.
Just take the sleeves right off. So this guy is a local actor who does pirate reenactments. And he gets the crowd going before ECU takes the field. Temple taking over here. Marshy's got time. And his pass falls incomplete with two flags coming in at the 23-yard line.
Colby Gore in coverage for the Pirates at the cornerback position. You mentioned
pass
two flags.
Defense, number 26.
And that's exactly who gets the flag.
I wouldn't be surprised on first down to see Temple come back to just a plain go route with Bryant, who's got great speed. He'll be the wide receiver to the wide side of the field on this first down opportunity. He had two steps.
Lined up at the bottom of your screen. It's a run here, and there are two more flags. David Hood on the carry for the Owls.
This has not been a clean football game.
Todd LaPenta is going to take our game checks today. He's been on the air more than we have.
I would think the Owls are going to be moving backwards.
Personal foul. He can block with the waist. offense, number 82. That penalty is declined. Personal foul, face mask, offense, number 53. Half is the goal, first down.
And not a good start for the Temple offense. You get a freebie on first down with the holding and the pass interference. Then you get the chop block. You get the low block by tight end Jake Robinson. You get the chop by Leon Johnson, the tackle. And the Owls are moving backwards now with the ball at the 11-yard line.
This is what you call offensively moonwalking.
Yeah.
First and 22.
Well, they have to get back to the running of David Hood, try to get themselves in a good third down opportunity as another flag comes down. Is this having something to do with the substitution?
Illegal substitution, offense, number 82. 5-yard penalty, first down.
It's probably a good thing offensive coordinator Dave Patnood's up in the box right now and not on the field, because I think head coach Jeff Collins is hot enough on the sidelines.
Hood's got across the 10, now outside the 20, and still going, pushed out of bounds. Just shy of the 30-yard line, so not much you can do in that situation, first and 27, but they make the best of it.
Well, that Hood run gets you healthy right away, and it's again to the outside. He goes for 18 yards, short side of the field. Not a Pirate in Black touches him until he goes down the field. Excuse me, that's a 22-yard gain on first down. Now you're in second and very manageable.
A lot easier here for Marshy. Armstead back into the game. He's not had a very productive handful of carries so far today. Maybe a half yard there after he fumbled earlier in the first quarter.
Mike, it just doesn't look like Armstead has that burst. You know, he's been injured for multiple weeks now. You're probably better off going with Hood, who just had that long run, so you take him out for a play. And now you have to stay on the field if you're Temple on third down. You have to find a way to get the football to Bryan. It's man-to-man coverage, bottom of your screen. Get a chance to your athlete to get the football.
Just one safety back deep for ECU. The throw is long enough to Kirkwood for a first down, and he breaks away across midfield, cutting his way back inside the 35-yard line. Exactly what Temple needed on third down.
What an effort by Keith Kirkwood. We talked about the inability of Armstead to get on the field because he's not 100%. Keith Kirkwood is finally 100%, and you can tell by this run after catch. It's over Gore. He splits two defenders at the end of this, goes for 37 yards, and that's an excellent effort by the fifth-year senior.
Kirkwood said he was ready to be back at 100%, and he's shown it so far. Marshy's in his danger zone, throwing on the run, incomplete. Flag drops to the 22.
Flag on the play. Pass incomplete, intended for number 27.
Holding, defense, number 56, 10-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Was there stoppage time in the U.S. soccer match last night? We might add a fifth quarter onto this game of stoppage time.
There have been a plethora of penalties today, and we're not at halftime.
But Temple has been moving, looking for more than 3 points to show for it, though. Closing in on the 9-minute mark in the second quarter.
Markwell Armstead on the carry. No gain on the play. Mike Myers on the tackle for the Pirates. Second down and 10.
So we talked about that shutout in the first quarter for ECU and just how, I guess you could say, surprising, honestly, it's been, because these numbers for ECU make them arguably the worst defense in college football.
Historically, this could be go down if they continue at this pace, which they are far from today. 128th in points per game. That's just at 50. You're doing a pretty good job today in a 3-3 ball game.
Marchi looking right, throws left, and it's dropped by Isaiah Wright.
The prior holding foul was against number six. Number six.
Noted. The yards per game is really what stands out, though, there at just a hair under 615. The most ever given up in a college football season was 2015 by Kansas at 560 a game.
Marshy needs to get good protection, stand in the pocket, and deliver here on third down.
Pocket was nicely formed around him. He throws inside the 10, and Wright makes up for the drop just one play later to set up first and goal, a catch of 16 yards.
Good protection on the inside. Marshy's able to step up, hold his ground in the pocket, and deliver a strike to the outside. That's what Temple needs to do on third down. Execute up front, keep your quarterback clean just long enough to find one of those athletes and Isaiah Wright on the outside. Now the big question is, Mike, can Temple finish by getting in the end zone?
Three receivers and a tight end. Third time in the red zone. Hood churning to the 5-yard line, still going laterally at the end of the run. Second and goal coming up for Temple. They're looking to get just their second rushing touchdown of the year if they can here on this drive. They've only got one so far, none from a running back. The only one they have this year belongs to the fullback, Nick Sharga.
Do they move the pocket to the wide side here on second and goal?
Exactly what Marshy does. Back corner of the end zone, and his throw is caught for a touchdown by Adonis Jennings. Right into the hedges as Temple takes the lead.
Nice call by offensive coordinator Dave Patnood. You go two big tight ends on the left side. You use a little bit of motion. You get your quarterback away from the fray, out on the edge, in a clean window to throw the football to on the outside. And he finds a playmaker in the corner of the end zone in Adonis Jennings.
A long drive that seemed almost insurmountable at the start, if you were to say it would end up in the end zone. The extra point is good. They started all the way back at their own 9-yard line, and they had first and 27 at their own 7-yard line. They just needed some time, some room. Marshy finds Jennings, and it's the Owls by 7. There can't be many people who could honestly have said 2 years ago that they knew the name Jalen Watts Jackson, but America did after that game a couple years ago at the Big House. Michigan State with that last second win over Michigan. They'll play under the lights tonight, and we are under beautiful sunshine today here in Greenville, North Carolina. Mike Cousins, John Kajemi, as Temple went from its own 9 to get into the end zone and take a 10-3 lead over ECU. Starting field position at the 14. Coming up here for the Pirates. We remind you that Allstate is proud to be part of the team that comes together to do good by contributing to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship funds. So down to score, first and 10, 14-yard line, about 7 minutes to go. What do you look for from ECU on this drive?
I look for Thomas Cirque to throw the football effectively out on the perimeter.
He goes to the freshman Pinnix, darting his way out of the backfield. The ball squirts out as he conquers the 15.
That's just like an extension of your running game on first down. You get a playmaker in space like Pinnix, a freshman, but that was a pretty good job of Temple coming up. It looked like it was going to be a gain of at least 5. They only get 1 on first down.
Now a pistol look as Temple shows pressure. Cirque throws over the top of the defense, and a looping toss goes to the 40-yard line. Davon Grayson, the team's leading receiver, with a catch of 26.
This is an odd defensive formation because you get a bust by your corner at the top of the screen. They're going to blitz from the wide side of the field, rotate the zone to the weak side, but the corner forgets to cover. There's a guy all by himself on the outside, and that's Davon Grayson. So good job by Cirque finding the open receiver.
Nobody was within 10 yards of him. Cirque back foot throw and has it picked off. Taken away by Delvon Randall. Second interception of the year for the junior safety.
Mike, this is a mistake you do not see. There's a late flag that came in, but Cirque's going to want to throw this football away.
Temple.
He's going to want to throw this football away, and he throws it right into coverage. Good break on the football by Randall. The ball just hangs in the middle of the football field. Can't do that when you have the experience of Thomas Cirque. It was a late decision to throw it down the middle, and Randall had it in his sights the entire way.
Second pick of the year for Randall, and the seventh time that Cirque has been intercepted.
He had two touchdowns last week, but two interceptions. This one, he knows he was late on the throw. It was a last-minute decision, not a good one from Thomas Cirque. And now, do you have sudden change on the other side of the field? What does Temple have drawn up for their sudden change play?
Timeout. Temple.
Well, Temple just had to take a timeout.
Take a timeout.
Because they came out onto the field when the play clock was down at 4. East Carolina down 7. Thomas Cirque with his 7th interception of the year gives it away to Temple, and a short field here for the Owls with 5:42 left in the second. Here's our championship drive update brought to you by Dr. Pepper, which means all these good teams in action 2 through 5. It's a great day to have the ESPN app.
How about the Georgia Bulldogs?
David Hood on the carry for Temple. Taking care of business against Vanderbilt, up 21-0. First down run for David Hood.
Clemson taking care of business. Oklahoma, one of those teams that loved to rely on Baker Mayfield. And Penn State getting it done against the Wildcats.
That's in the second quarter. Right now over on ABC. Marshy back to throw. One-on-one into the end zone. And the pass too far, out wide, looking for Marshall Ellick.
Marcus Holton, the cornerback for the Pirates defensively, does a nice job of sticking to the receiver and then forcing him out of bounds. Little contact before the ball got there, but a good job of getting the receiver out of bounds on a good throw from Logan Marshy.
Third down and 3. Marshy pressured. Throws wide off the fingertips. Broderick Yancey.
Tyree Owens, the defensive tackle for the Pirates. He's the guy that forced the pass. Maybe a count early on Logan Marshy. Ball was still on target and on time, but if he had one more second, he may have been able to throw a more accurate football to the outside.
And the offense appears to be staying on the field here. So 4th and 3, the Owls going for it with the ball on the ECU 27-yard line. Marshy loads up, throwing inside the 10-yard line, and a leaping attempt. Adonis Jennings down to the 2-yard line.
What a catch. Great coverage by Colby Gore, but a better throw, and how about the concentration catch by Adonis Jennings? It looks like he gets his foot down as he climbs the ladder. It's clearly in bounds. What a terrific job of going up to get the football and getting one foot in bounds. He goes up and gets that 50-50 ball over Gore, And there's the foot in bounds.
First charge. Timeout. ECU.
At first glance, Mike, it really looked like a clean catch by Adonis Jennings. Goes up to get the football. He possesses it there. Let's see that foot inbounds right there. Yes, left foot inbounds. Possesses it through the catch. That looks like a clean one to me, and actually Temple inside the 5-yard line.
The operative phrase on a play like that going out of bounds is firm control.
Yes.
That is firm control. That's a textbook definition of it.
Right through the arm of Colby Gore.
So it's first and goal at the 2 for Temple. David Hood, the running back, with Marshy. He takes the handoff. Going backwards, standing up, and he is in. Touchdown, David Hood. And it's 6 more on the board for the Owls.
Tough running inside the tackles on a guy that's going to be relied on for 11 attempts on 66 yards. Finally gets into the end zone. With the injury to Armstead, they're a more experienced running back. All arrows point to 24, and he's got the job done so far with 4:34 left to go before halftime.
Extra point is good. Temple cashes in on the interception thrown by Thomas Sirk. David Hood, tireless, perseveres his way to pay dirt. One touchdown by air and one by ground. Tack on a field goal as well for Temple. And that's the 17-3 advantage for the Owls as East Carolina gets set to go back on offense. About 4.5 minutes left here before halftime.
Good strong running by David Hood so far in this football game, replacing Raquel Armstead, who was injured this week and a couple weeks playing hurt. The Temple scoring drive, 5 plays. They finally get into the end zone on the ground. And now the defense will have to answer. And speaking of answering, Mike, we were talking during the break. You know, offense has to do something before halftime for East Carolina.
They're going to need to get it going. We remind you to get your NFL Sunday started with us on ESPN. 10 Eastern, Sunday NFL countdown. The entire crew will have all the early breaking stories, injury updates, and preview each game right up until kickoff. You can catch it also streaming live on the ESPN app. Offensively speaking, ECU over the last 3 games, they've scored 68 points in the first half. Today, just 3 so far. On the run, Tyshawn Dye, a grad transfer from Clemson. And they lost Zay Jones last year. He graduated now with the Buffalo Bills. Most catches all time in FBS history. And that came on the heels of the tremendous career of Justin Hardy.
Two great playmakers in Pirate history with the number of catches and receptions they were able to put on the board.
Second down throw is tipped from Sirk, incomplete. It'll bring up 3rd and 12. And interestingly enough, Tony Peterson, the offensive coordinator for ECU, now in his 2nd year here, said not having Zay Jones has actually, in some ways, made things a little bit easier. Not to say you're better off not having a guy like Zay Jones, but that as long as Sirk makes the right decision, you have so many talented options that he's bound to make the right choice more often than not. Off-balance throw, and that's just a drop. Jimmy Williams was there right near the sticks. And not a lot of time coming off the clock for ECU as they're going to punt it away.
And there's one of those talented options that normally a sure-handed receiver on the outside. Jimmy Williams lets this ball get into his body right through his hands. It looks like he goes up and he's going to catch the football. Good effort, but lack of execution brings on the punting unit.
I think Mike Jones, the cornerback behind him, if he had been anticipating a drop, could have just sped the other way with that type of play that 9.5 times out of 10 ends up being a catch, and then he's getting ready to make a tackle. And here is Jones on the return. A lot of east-west, and now trying to cut it back. Grabbed by the shoulder pads and brought down to the 32.
Late flag as well, Mike, on the play again. It's probably the fifth or sixth time a flag comes in after the play. Jones running all over the field, may have run 20 or 30 yards to go backwards.
Personal foul, horse collar, kicking team, number 26, 15-yard penalty.
Looks like they're going to get Gore on the horse collar tackle at the end of this play. Mike Jones trying to go to the right side. He eludes multiple black jerseys, and the horse collar is going to come in right there at the end of the play. Looked like that was on Chris Love.
Correction, the foul is on number 35.
Chris Love is 35 for the Pirates on the special teams horse collar tackle, so the ball closer to the 50-yard line for the Owls.
Plenty of time and a short field for Temple.
Trayvon Williams on the carry for Temple.
It's Trayvon Williams, native of Philadelphia, who got his first carry of the season last week against Houston. Again, with them just being down to two scholarship running backs, so he comes off here. It's been him and David Hood for the most part in the backfield for Temple.
If you're Temple, you would love to take this clock down and get points. It doesn't have to be a touchdown. You'd like to get six, but you want to get points to end the half here.
Fullback Rich Rovato.
45,
Logan Marshy's been directing this offense for Temple today. 11 of 20, 182 yards, has the touchdown, the one interception in the red zone. That's the one blemish on his day, but he's been effective after that mistake, coming back and moving the offense fairly effectively for head coach Jeff Collins.
His touchdown to interception ratio much better than what he's done the last 2 weeks, which
That's
is
true.
One touchdown and six interceptions. Marshy on third down lets it fly deep downfield, and the pass is caught inside the 5 yard line by Randall Jones.
Pass complete to number 81, Randall Jones.
There's the explosive play from Temple, 45 yards down the field. Marshy on target and on time again, standing tall in the pocket, giving his playmaker on the outside an opportunity to catch the football. And it's Randall Jones, who only came in to the game with 4 catches on the season, his biggest so far this season.
Now, not a great sequence of plays for the cornerback, Chris Love, called for the penalty. And now hurt over the top. Play clock was down to 0.
Delay game. Offense. 5 yard penalty. First down.
And the snap just a hair late.
And with Temple burning all of their timeouts pre-snap with a minute 44 left to go before halftime, that has to be a frustrating topic to discuss at halftime, or maybe even tomorrow, for the offense for head coach Jeff Collins. They've wasted some timeouts early in the football game. Didn't have one there for Logan Marshy to take.
Marshy gives it to Rich Rovato, still standing, and tumbles forward inside the 5 yard line.
If I'm Temple, I come back with the exact same play, same formation, same play, hand it to Rich Rovato.
It looked like they were thinking what you were thinking.
ECU.
And it forces ECU into using its second timeout. So Marshy is trying to get Temple to pay dirt one more time here before the first half comes to a close. The redshirt sophomore quarterback from Bristol, Connecticut. Sat down with him yesterday. Very impressive young guy.
Yes, he was.
And although he's got the left sleeve today, the long sleeve shirt, you can see the tattoos just peeking out a little bit there So he's got La Familia written in Italian on his arm. And then that stairway that's climbing up is representative of not only Led Zeppelin, but also the stairs he's taken over the course of his career, the upward climb that it's been for him. It's Ritrovato testing the left side with the pile and across the goal line into the end zone for a touchdown.
Really good offensive line surge on that left side, and you give it to your big fullback, Ritrovato, in between the tackles. His first touchdown of the season. Both fullbacks have rushing touchdowns on the year. And Rob Ritrovato is going to go off the left side, find a little crease in the Pirates' defense, and then that offensive line just aiding him into the end zone.
And a chance to make it 24-3. Now, Logan Marcia, he's got a few more tattoos there on that arm as well. He's got another one, a Drake lyric on his arm that says, "Back then they didn't want me. I'm blessed now." Originally was going to go to UConn. Things didn't work out there for him. They have worked out for him at Temple.
Well, things working out for the Owls on the road at ECU. 24-3 with a minute five before halftime, led by their redshirt sophomore quarterback. Another explosive play to get this team in the red zone, and they're finishing today much better than they have coming into the game. Three touchdowns on five possessions. He did throw the interception on a bad decision, but has bounced back effectively to lead this team to 24 first half points.
And the last piece of literature he has tattooed on the shoulder is,
now that you mention it,
"The Road Less Traveled."
That's right.
By Robert Frost. Would you say fullback touchdown is the road less traveled?
Yes. It's been traveled today. Five plays, 68 yards, 2:33 off the clock. And not only does Rich Rivato have a touchdown, Temple doing much better taking advantage of field position.
Bumeri has been an active kicker today. No chance for a return. Well, Temple 0-2 in the American this year. Maybe on their way to their first win, but not far removed from where they were at the end of last year. The American Conference Championship game. PJ Walker, the quarterback, helping lead that team. What ended up being the final season for Matt Rhule, as he helped bring them to the top of the conference before heading off for Baylor. And they got a 34-10 victory over Navy. It was 3-0 East Carolina after one. Now in this second quarter, the Pirates have been outscored 24-0.
ECU.
Well, after a loss on first down, ECU is going to take their last timeout of the first half with 58 seconds left to go. When you have a veteran quarterback like Thomas Sirk and all of these wide receivers, I think you got to try to push the football down the field here and try to get a touchdown, get points before halftime. Maybe not time for that east-west swing pass on first down.
Sirk is playing with a head coach with whom he's very familiar. He's never played a college game without Scotty Montgomery coaching him in one form or another, either as the head coach here or offensive coordinator at Duke. He flings it up toward the sideline, and that's well out of bounds and over the head of Jimmy Williams.
Temple's done a nice job defensively. They came into the game wanting to pressure the pocket and bring more pressure with more bodies, but just with four on second down, they were able to make Thomas Sirk very uncomfortable in the pocket. There's no one down here covering a wideout. Now, finally, Temple gets organized.
Sirk throws it away again, this time on third and 15.
Thomas Sirk's pass is incomplete. Flag on the play.
That might have been the worst set of downs East Carolina's had offensively as another flag comes on. I'm not so sure Temple had 12 guys.
Defense, intentional grounding, offense, fouls offset. Third down.
So you were saying?
there was mass confusion defensively for Temple. And as Cirk was going back, I'm not so sure. It looked like the ball got past the line of scrimmage, but the official saw it a different way. It might have been inside the tackle box.
So still third and 15. It's a five-man rush by the Owls. Under pressure, a throw to midfield is tipped and incomplete. Three defenders swarming on top of Davon Grayson. Really had a very difficult time just trying to get to that ball.
And a difficult time in the pocket for Thomas Cirque trying to get the football off again. Temple up front is able to disrupt the timing in the pass offense. Sean Bradley comes from that linebacker spot, making Thomas Cirque throw the football, not a lot on it. He had to throw the football a little bit early, maybe a count early than he would have liked.
Austin Barnes, the graduate transfer punter from Eastern Michigan, gets the kick away. And it settles at the 41. So still 28 seconds left here on the clock for Temple.
Temple doesn't have any timeouts remaining. I think they'd be content to go to the locker room up 24-3 here. Let's see what offensive coordinator Dave Patenaude has up his sleeve with just 28 seconds left before halftime.
Especially given what you just said, when you contrast it with what their first half yielded last week.
That's right.
Temple found itself down 20-0 at one point last week against Houston before mounting a comeback rally that fell short. So they're running some deep routes here on first down as Marshy gets outside the pocket and just elects to go short.
What a great job of getting out of bounds by David Hood. Second and third effort. That's a terrific job of being aware by Hood to get out of bounds. No timeouts remaining for either team. And Hood's able to find this football around four or five black jerseys. So there's one, two, three, four, and gets out of bounds.
Dead ball fouls against both teams. After the play, personal foul. Defense number 6, offense number 81, fouls offset. Down will count, second down.
So 19 seconds left for Temple, not content perhaps just to walk it off. Already 324 first half yards over their season average. Now Marshy sideline again, and there is a flag which comes at midfield.
I'm not so sure the receivers were set to the wide side of the field.
An eligible player downfield, offense number 13, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Wide out Isaiah Wright.
There are some correctable calls offensively, defensively, special teams for both head coaches after 30 minutes or close to 30 minutes of football.
So after looking to go deep downfield on the first couple plays, Temple puts it on the ground and brings an end to a flag-laden first half here at Dowdy-Fickley Stadium in North Carolina. 24-3, though. Things are looking up for Temple. Stay tuned for halftime. We'll have updates along with stats, analysis, and highlights from this one. Coming up, Pirates brought a good fight, but not good enough in half number one, because the Owls, they're not dormant this afternoon. Flying high, 24-3. ESPN College Football Today is presented by Vizio. Welcome back to Dowdy Ficklin Stadium in Greenville, North Carolina. At the half, a big lead for the Temple Owls out in front 24-3, their biggest lead of the season. They were scoreless through the first 15 minutes, but exploded in the second. Along with John Kajemi, Mike Cousins, so glad to have you with us here on a hot bit of a sizzler today in North Carolina. This is our game track brought to you by Taco Bell.
It was all Temple in the second quarter, 24 unanswered. Marshy's done a nice job at the quarterback spot, bouncing back from an early interception. And Temple, 327 total yards through 30 minutes.
ECU gets the football to start half number two, and they'll get it on the 25-yard line. Last week, you remember, negative rushing yards in the first half for Temple, 150 in the second, and they're closing in on 100 here in this game.
And it's been helpful that David Hood's been able to replace an injured Raquel Armstead and be able to get some explosive plays here. A 22-yarder on first and forever when Temple's offense was backed up in the shadow of their own goal line, and he was able to keep hopes alive before halftime with second and third effort. We've seen him carry the football with authority 12 times for 69 yards, has a touchdown in between the tackles as well. So he's had some outside running, some catching, and some inside the tackles tough running.
So ECU starting their drive and going backwards on first down. A loss of a couple with the handoff going to Darius Pinnix on first down. Pinnix, the freshman from Elon, North Carolina, got talked up a lot by his coaching staff this week. Cirque looking to take a shot. And there are multiple flags, three as a matter of fact, coming in as Davon Grayson went up for the ball.
Pass interference, defense, number 11, automatic first down.
Flags are on the cornerback, Linwood Crump.
At some point, if you're a cornerback, you have to turn and locate the football. He's playing the man here pretty good on the outside in Grayson, but you have to turn and locate the football and make a play on the football, or else you may get four or five flags the next time. There were three on that play.
Grayson back on the field this year after missing out on last year's season because of bulging discs in his back. Leaping grab at midfield. Cirque puts it on target for Jimmy Williams. First down.
Really good job by Thomas Cirque staying in the pocket. Strong safety Sean Chandler came on a delayed blitz. He was about a step too late, and that's all Thomas Cirque needed to scan the football field to the right, hang in that pocket, and deliver that football to Jimmy Williams.
After the 13-yard pickup, Cirque hands it off. Hassan Howell, the running back, scrambles forward on the play.
This is what East Carolina needs to do. They need to take control and move the football in this opening drive of the third quarter. Cirque's numbers, 11 of 20 for 147 and an interception in the first 30 minutes.
Cirque and the Pirates have their drive slowed down now as there's an injured Temple player on the field. It's the defensive tackle, Julian Taylor. We'll take a timeout. East Carolina on the move. Good to see Temple's Julian Taylor walking off the field there after he got caught up in the collision on the running play. Senior from Glenside, Pennsylvania.
Taylor pursuing the runner Howe. Just his helmet gets the hip. One of the offensive linemen looked like Messiah Rice. Glad to see him walk off on his own power.
Brings up second down and four.
Fumble
for ECU. Ball comes loose. ECU quickly falls right back on top of it. Howe, the running back, there to scoop up the mistake.
And you've got momentum going to open up the half, and you're down 24-3. The last thing you want to do is lay that football on the grass. So now third and medium for quarterback Thomas Cirque and the playmakers on the outside. I would expect pressure from the front four. They've done a good job of just sending four on third down.
And they do again here. He quickly gets rid of the ball, throwing it to the sticks. And then an extra push will be enough for a first down for ECU. So down 24-3, John, but with the way that ECU can move the ball, they're a top 15 passing offense. It will be no surprise if they found themselves quickly back in them.
It would be no surprise if they go up top here after making that first down, crossing the 40-yard line. Try to get a quick strike.
Cirque likes the look, throws into double coverage, and the pass is incomplete. Nearly taken away by a safety, Sean Chandler, on his back.
Sean Chandler was one step away from a sack earlier in this drive, and now he's one step away from getting there just in time to pick off a Thomas Cirque pass. Good coverage on the outside. They funnel to the safety who's coming off the hash. That's three, Sean Chandler, who goes up and makes an excellent play on the football.
Out of the pocket on second and 10, with momentum stepping into the throw. Nice grab, Davon Grayson tiptoeing the sideline, moves the chains, picks up 14 yards.
Good movement from Thomas Cirque to extend this play and then drive the football on the Pirates sideline. Good awareness of where your playmakers are, avoiding pressure and driving the football down the field.
Right on the door of the red zone, ECU only got there twice in the first half. Hassan Howe, the running back, makes the catch, brought down by Chappelle Russell, a linebacker.
What an effort by Russell, because this is a walk-in touchdown. Great call by Tony Peterson on the offensive side of the football. Everybody in a white shirt's around Cirque. One player can make the play, and that's Russell, and he does.
Cirque bought lots of time, and across the middle of the field, Quay Johnson keeps the drive going.
ECU now inside the 15, down to the 11, and this is where Thomas Cirque, and he can run the football. This is where you have to account for the quarterback run.
Cirque under pressure, lofts it to the corner of the end zone, a leaping try, and a touchdown for ECU. Quay Johnson with his first touchdown of the year from 11 yards out.
Who wants the football more? On this play, it looked like Quay Johnson. Just an inside stop route. He spins out of that, goes to the back corner, and fights for the football over Foster, the cornerback. And that's just will of an outside playmaker trying to get it into the end zone and back into this football game.
So just like that, a quick strike for the Pirates. And they trim the Temple advantage to 14. The question will be, as it has
12 carries for 69 yards, and now leaning on the quarterback to make a play on third down.
Blitz comes up the middle. Hood stays on his feet and gets away from it. First down out to the 42-yard line.
Yards after contact has been the story for David Hood. He's been hit at the line of scrimmage. He's been hit down the field, but he continues to move forward. Good balance shown here by the offhand, going to the ground and getting the first down.
10-yard run for the redshirt junior from Galloway, New Jersey. Marshy stared right down exactly where he wanted to go with it, and that ball was tipped by Galen Elmore, the defensive lineman who transferred in after graduating from Minnesota.
Elmore does an excellent job along the line of scrimmage. His eyes are in the backfield. He anticipates the throw to the edge the entire time. Almost got both hands on the football, which would have been an incredible interception, but a good negative play on first down.
Elmore in and out of Foster housing growing up. Graduated in 3 years from Minnesota. And now coming here to finish off his college career. growing up, his parents were addicts, and just in his first year with social services alone, he said he stayed in 19 different homes.
Wow.
Originally born in Peoria, Illinois, got taken in by a family in Somerset, Wisconsin, really thrived there, the first in his family to graduate from college. Third down and seven, that pass too strong. Down the seam and incomplete.
That's exactly what ECU wanted to do defensively. Yes, they allowed Temple to move the football a little bit, but Elmore and company rise to the occasion to bring on the Temple punting unit. This is good coverage down the field. Logan Marshy trying to get the football over the middle, had his guy, but just overshoots Bryant, who was open on the in route.
First punt of the day coming here for Temple. That's kind of jarring. Midway through the third quarter, it's the first punt. Quay Johnson inside the 10-yard line on the return. Now he's got some space coming up the sideline with blockers in front to the 28-yard line. Nicely done by the wide receiver for ECU. There is a flag down, sitting out near midfield.
During the kick, holding, receiving team. Timeout.
Well, if you joined us late or missed the first half, there were 11 penalties recorded in the first half. More than that, though, declined, waved off. And here's another one for ECU. Pirates hoping for more great play from Thomas Sirk and Quay Johnson, who brings us a couple of nice grabs on the last drive. It's our All-State all-hands-in from Quay Johnson.
Two big catches on that last touchdown scoring drive. The only third down conversion of the drive. Johnson's able to make someone miss in the middle of the field, move the chains, and then on the stop-and-go route, he's going to climb the ladder, take it away from Artrell Foster in the corner of the end zone. That's two big plays to get the Pirates back in this football game.
This drive starts from their own 3-yard line, and they're looking at single coverage down the sideline. Wow! Jimmy Williams hauls it in, and he goes all the way out to the 38-yard line, a pickup of 35 on first down.
Explosive plays are in this ECU offense when you have an experienced quarterback and terrific athletes on the outside. Jimmy Williams tracks this football. Excellent job of catching. They're going back to him again.
Could have been a touchdown on that play. Some miscommunication between Sirk and Williams, who not only had his defender beat, but didn't have anybody behind him.
Coach is trying to get him straight off the line of scrimmage. He had another step behind Mike Jones. Would have been back-to-back explosive plays.
Free play here for ECU. Sirk going deep again when he knows that flag has been dropped. The pass is incomplete. Sirk wants another flag. But they'll get at least a small chunk here.
Offside. Defense. Number 95. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Smart play by Thomas Sirk. Knew he had the free play, as you called, Mike. Throws it up. Tried to get either the big catch down the field or pass interference against Jeff Collins' defense. Important for Temple now to make a play to force ECU into a third down.
Design run for Sirk with nice blocking in front. Takes a hit in the knee and gets right near midfield. Moving the chains for ECU. Came into the game as their leading rusher.
Absolutely. Had two touchdowns last week in a loss here at home against USF. But he has the ability to do that. Just when you lose sight of Sirk running the football, he'll do it for a big game.
With four receivers, the handoff goes for Pinnix. The freshman slips one tackle. And there's a flag back at the 50-yard line. They'll want to scrimmage.
Personal foul. Chop block. Offense. Number 70 and number 78. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Looked like Rice and Heron, left guard and left tackle on the chop block. Left side of your screen, tackle and guard engage the same player, defensive tackle and chop block right at the point of attack on Booth Lloyd. It's an easy one for the officials and ECU moving backwards.
First down and 25.
Pass complete to number 83.
They'll try and get this yardage back here. That goes to Cam Marshman, the wide receiver.
Well, Mike, Temple has to take advantage of that chop block opportunity and get off the field with their defense. Can't afford to let East Carolina pick up a first and 25 and turn that into a first down. Here comes pressure at the line of scrimmage.
Just a four-man rush for the Owls. Cirque in comfortable space. Incomplete, looking for Trayvon Brown.
A tight window on the Temple sideline. That was good coverage. Over the top by Crump and underneath by Graham Mobley.
Now third and 22. It's not an easy down and distance, but it's one where Cirque has shown his ability to land the deep ball today.
Can you come up and tackle in space? Keep everything in front of you if you're the Temple defense.
Corners are about 15 yards off the receivers at the line of scrimmage. How underneath? Set up about fourth and eight.
That's exactly what you wanted to do if you're Temple on defense. Come up, make the play. It's fourth and about 10 yards, fourth and maybe nine to go. Bring on the punting unit, get your offense back on the field, and start running this clock towards the end of the third quarter.
The Owls looking for their first conference win of the season. Losses in back-to-back weeks against USF on the road and then last week against Houston at home by just a score. They were down 3-0 in this one after the first quarter. Scored 24 straight. Barnes' kick bounces too long there for ECU.
Ball goes into the end zone for touchback. Temple takes over first and 10 at the 20.
The officials are discussing. I don't see a flag on the field, Mike, but the officials are talking like there's one. I'm not so sure, yeah, Mike, that there wasn't contact with catch interference on the punt, but I didn't see a flag on the play. The officials discussing it, but not going to make the call. Here's the contact on Chandler. He's faking. The ball's going to go to his left. He's not going to catch it, but there's definitely contact on the punt returner.
Well, in some cases, it's been a perplexing afternoon, to say the least.
There's been so many flags, I guess they decided to hold those. As a result, no gain on first down, so Temple now second and 10, ball on their own 20-yard line. Logan Marshy trying to stay hot in this football game.
Going to the sideline, and it's Adonis Jennings there. So they've shown multiple looks there. They have got, in the backfield on that play, a running back and a fullback, and that's part of what has been vexing for opposing defenses, including Robert Prunty, who took over here as defensive coordinator after just a couple of weeks with the number of looks they've shown and what they've been able to do. Injured player here for ECU is Keontae Anderson, the defensive end. So timeout on the field, 4:20 left third quarter. Keontae Anderson, the senior defensive end from right here in Greenville, off the field and will get looked at by the training staff from ECU. Third down and three coming up here with the ball on the 27-yard line and a critical moment in the game with 4:20 left and a two-score contest with ECU trailing.
Yeah, this is where East Carolina's their defense needs to rise up and get a stop. Third and very short. Fullback in the football game in Rich Rivado.
Just a four-man rush from the Pirates. Marshy throwing sideline.
What a
Kirkwood.
Catch.
Kirkwood. And he got it along the sideline. Second straight night in the American Conference where there's been a marvelous one-handed catch.
Talk about concentration, back shoulder throw, tracking the football the entire way is Keith Kirkwood. Sticks out that left hand and scoops it in. Just a terrific catch on third down.
Now Marshy takes the corner, pitches it back for the fullback, Rich Rivado. What concentration from Kirkwood.
Well, to be able to spin and track the football away from the defender, stick out that left mitt, and then control it with getting a foot inbounds. That's just excellent stuff from Keith Kirkwood, who's finally 100%. Four catches, 79 yards. A couple of acrobatic catches on the afternoon.
It's just such a stark difference for Marshy from when he has his feet set to when he doesn't have his feet set and how accurate his throws are. Injured player here for ECU is the defensive tackle, Raekwon Purvis.
Well, you hope Purvis is okay because you've got Anderson. That was out a couple of plays before. He has not returned. So a couple of starters on the defensive side when you desperately need to get off the field for head coach Scotty Montgomery.
Montgomery's going to go out on the field, check things out. 3:17 here in the third. Let's check in with Chris Cotter in the studio.
We've got an upset brewing in Norman. Well, after an Oklahoma turnover, here comes Kyle Kemp, the backup quarterback for Iowa State. Hits Marchie Murdoch. Love it when a plan comes together. Murdoch scores. They go for two, down two. And it's Alan Lazard on the receiving end of this conversion. 24-24 Cyclones and Sooners in Norman, guys.
Very few shortages of exciting action in the Big 12 week in and week out. We've got a 24-10 game here, 3:17 left in third, and we take a look at our college football AP top 10 this week. And it's a very tough task for A&M going up against number one. They've rattled off four straight wins, but what Alabama has done scoring-wise and what the points allowed in the last 2 weeks has been remarkable.
That's right. And other teams on that top 10, Oklahoma in a struggle. We saw that. Penn State and Georgia taking care of business.
So on this drive, two defensive linemen injured for ECU, Purvis and Anderson.
Number 45, Rob.
Rich Rivado through the middle of the line.
I come back with the same play, same formation. Get your big running back going north and south. Look at this, different formation here for the Owls.
They lined up like this once earlier in the game and didn't end up snapping the ball. This time they do, and Isaiah Wright takes the handoff. The wide receiver gets the first down, Temple. He was their third leading rusher last year. Came into this game with seven carries. They intentionally forced the ball into his hand several times last week, trying to, at least it appeared to us, get the ball away from the Houston defensive line and Big Ed Oliver.
Well, that was the plan because they have so much faith in Wright and Bryant and Jennings on the outside. And Kirkwood came in to play today with two spectacular catches.
So loaded up, two fullbacks on the field here. And they both stay in to block for Marshy, who throws it down the sideline, and he's got a man wide open. Isaiah Wright sneaks away from the defense and scores a Temple touchdown. 30-10, Owls.
Let's credit this offensive line for Logan Marshy. He's able to just stand in the pocket tall, scan the secondary, and find his wide receiver wide open. This is just terrific job, keeping his eyes down the field. You bust as a linebacker in Gutierrez, wide open is right down the rail for 6 points.
Well, we were told by the Temple staff yesterday, expect to see both fullbacks in the game at some point. And you thought it was going to be a running play, most
That's
likely.
Right.
And instead, it turns into a beautiful wheel route for Isaiah Wright.
Well, he's the playmaker we talked about. You know, you convert on third down, your offensive line protects, you're able to have success down the field. It gets easy when you can stand in the pocket like that. You know, let's credit Keith Kirkwood. He's the guy that kept the drive alive with an acrobatic catch. The offense stays on the field. Offensive line does their job. And you've got plenty of playmakers to distribute the football to when you have time, like Logan Marshy had.
So just a hair under 3 minutes on that drive for Temple, up 21-10 over ECU.
I would think head coach Jeff Collins knows he has to continue to keep that pedal down and continue to try to get into the end zone and score points, but after ECU came out and scored to make it 24-10, his offense found a way to answer.
Trayvon Brown back deep for the Pirates.
Trayvon Brown lets it bounce 6 yards deep in the end zone. Tonight after Cal and Washington on ESPN, make sure you tune in for SportsCenter at night with Stan Verrett and Linda Cohn from L.A. They'll have all the college football highlights, plus the NL Division Series games, the NHL, NBA preseason, NFL news, and everything else. SportsCenter at night also streaming live on the ESPN app. Tough time to be a Yankees fan, huh?
Boy, tough loss last night for all those Yankee fans.
Somewhere, our producer Eric Posman is shaking his head.
For some reason, he's not talking to me anymore.
Are these lines still connected here? Second and five. Penix testing the left side.
There is Penix on the carry. Picks up 3 yards. Benny Walls on the stop of the Owls. Third down and three.
Penix, the type of guy that Tony Peterson, the offensive coordinator, hopes in time can be a 20 to 25 carry a game type of guy.
And the way the game was going early, you felt like he was going to get close to 15 or 20 touches.
But the score has forced them into moving the ball through the air a lot more. That ball was tipped and in and out of the hands of Benny Walls, the safety for Temple.
And that should have gone the other way. Benny Walls had that red from the snap of the football. All he had to do was look at the eyes of Thomas Sirk and catch the football. This ball is coming into the lap of Benny Walls. He breaks on it perfectly. He's got it in front of him. And the Temple sideline's going, what do you mean you dropped the football? That was a good break on the ball. All he has to do is finish.
Now, ECU is making a pretty big statement right now about its defense. Going for it here on fourth down. Probably don't trust that unit a lot. The numbers speak to that, and they turn it over on downs. Jacob Martin, the defensive end, helps bring Sirk to the ground and bring the drive to an end.
Well, you can feel Temple getting all the momentum after that last touchdown. The defense comes out. You almost get an interception. You come out on fourth down. You get a big stop on Sirk. Nowhere to go with the football. He's looking to the right first. Sirk will scan back to the left, but that pocket closes very quickly due to Jacob Martin coming in and taking down the veteran quarterback. You can see the excitement on the Temple sidelines. They know this game is starting to trend in their direction.
Martin's a guy who's on track to graduate in December from Temple. Marshy wants the end zone on first down. Targeting and incomplete. Targeting that back corner of the end zone.
That was a pretty good job by Ventel Bryant going from wide receiver to defensive back. This is good coverage on the corner by Colby Gore. He's going to go up, finally locates the football, goes up. It looks like he's going to make the interception. And then Bryant fights back for the incompletion.
After the shot at the end zone, David Hood goes off to the right side for a pickup of five. Jacob Martin, that defensive end, who brought down Thomas Cirque to bring the drive to a close as well. Here's a guy who's going to get his degree in broadcast journalism and is an aspiring photographer as well. This is just from one of his two Instagram accounts that he has. And find him at Jacob Shoots on Instagram. We spent about 15 minutes with him yesterday. He's the type of guy that if you put a camera in front of him, he's got energy that just jumps right out at you.
He's an engaging guy, as you said, wants to be in broadcast journalism, loves the X Games. He's a big fan of that. And, you know, his mom encouraged him, go out and see the world. He had siblings that have gone all over the country for college. When he found Temple, he said, I'm going to get to play big-time football in a big-time city. And the story is his now on the defensive side.
He knew Philadelphia was home and has made a home on the defensive line no matter where the Owls have traveled. They've been successful today here in Eastern North Carolina, 31-10 at the end of three quarters. Watch me do this. Since 2012, I've been the coolest if you do not get it. Start of the fourth quarter here at ECU. It's the American Conference on ESPN as Temple looks to add to its lead. 31-10 is the score with the Owls out in front. Now a field goal try for Aaron Boomering. Yards on this one. And it's true, 34-10. Just a few ticks off the fourth quarter clock. As Temple is in control.
Thank you.
Well, weather be darned, you brought the costume. You're wearing it till the end. Especially when your team's up by 24.
You got to be hot down there with, in full garb, I would think. The guy on the right's probably the brains of the outfit.
Off a Temple field goal. It's fielded at the 5-yard line for ECU. Trayvon Brown on the return. There is a flag in, multiple flags, as he goes out of bounds along the sideline.
There have been multiple flags on
multiple plays.
Personal foul. Illegal block below the waist. Kicking team. Number 19. 15-yard penalty. First down.
ECU made a pretty big statement ending its last drive by going for it deep, pinned back deep in its own territory. And at that point, I think they said, if we don't get this here,
it's four down territory for the fourth quarter, I would think.
We know where this game is going, and yeah, we know where the fans are going at the moment. They are heading for cover because the skies have just opened up, and it has started to pour here in Greenville. Cirque, under pressure, was clobbered as he got rid of that one, incomplete on first down. We had pre-game rain this morning, probably between 8 and 9 o'clock. And it's not as though there are a multitude of storm clouds overhead. This probably will be a passing shower here, but it's made people scramble pretty quickly.
And Cirque has been scrambling out of the pocket with this four-man Temple rush.
Pressured again, and the ball dropped by Penix. Well, it's been unfortunate for the Pirates, among many things today, is that they haven't been able to set up the run game for Cirque. And now with the score the way it's been most of the day, that's not an option.
Well, other than the first quarter where the score was manageable, they've been in pass mode, and they've had some explosive plays. But Temple, you have to give their offense credit. Every time they had a chance to stay on the field, convert a third down, take the football away, they've done a really good job of taking advantage of their opportunities.
Third down conversions have been great today for Temple, 9 for 14. Cirque stepping up into this throw, but couldn't get a lot of body into it, and overthrows Davon Grayson. Now fourth down.
Head coach Scotty Montgomery deciding to bring the offense off the field and punt this football away with 14 minutes and 30 seconds left to go in the contest.
Barnes, one of a handful of graduate transfers on this roster. He came from Eastern Michigan. Wow, he got a lot into that one. Doesn't matter who you'd have sprinting down the field because nobody's catching up with it. And a touchback. Quickly, we go to the studio. Here's Chris Cotter.
All right, update on this Oklahoma situation. It is not good for the Sooners. We're in the fourth quarter, all tied up. Kyle Kemp, the backup quarterback for Iowa State here, finding Trevor Ryan, 57 yards. And just like that, number three in the country, Oklahoma, trailing the Cyclones in the fourth quarter.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Vizio, maker of award-winning 4K displays.
It's been an illuminating performance from the Temple offense today, 34-10 as they've lit up this ECU defense. Just 40 seconds into this fourth quarter, Mike Cousins and John Kangemi with you here from Dowdy Ficklin Stadium in Greenville, North Carolina. So season highs in passing yards and total yards. Logan Marshy came in knowing exactly what he thought he was going to see today and has taken advantage, executing their game plan to a T.
And Mike, they've really done a nice job of staying on the field on third down, 9 of 14 on third down.
Nick Sharga, the fullback, gets the carry. We've talked a lot about fullbacks today for Temple. Rob Ritrovato has gotten a handful of carries.
What are those fullbacks?
Sharga just plowing his way through there. He's on track to graduate in December as well. Easy to spot because of his long hair. He's also a guitar player.
Heard that.
They've let him out before practice to let some chords rip on the guitar out on the practice fields at Temple. And they're going to use him to try and run out some clock here. But him and Rich Rivato, the other fullback, both guys who are former walk-ons who came in as linebackers. They bring that same effort and intensity from the defensive side to the offensive side. Sharga last week, as a matter of fact, had such a hard hit on Houston's Ed Oliver, the nose tackle, he knocked him out for the game. He takes all three carries on the drive.
It looks like that ball is going to touch the 30-yard line. Should be a first down. Three straight runs in between the tackles for Temple as they try to get this clock moving with just under 13 minutes to go in the game.
Charge timeout. ECU. Is challenging the spot as well. There's a review.
Hey, back David Hood.
And if you're ECU, you just have to try to get your hands on the football, tackle the football, because you're going to see nothing but running. And Mike, maybe in this one you may see a lot of running too.
Just the fourth night game in the history of Michigan Stadium. It'll be a difficult test for Michigan State against one of the best defenses in America. First in the country in yards allowed for the Wolverines, and they've only given up four touchdowns total this year. Now Hood goes to the wide side and gets sent backwards. Ball comes loose at the end of the play, although he's ruled down at the 34.
I would think on third down for Temple, you want to go in between the tackles as Rich Rivato comes into the game. Hood, who was once over 100 yards, now may be under 100 with that loss on second down. .99 total yards for David Hood, who's been a workhorse in this Owls offense. In between the tackles, bouncing it outside. Really the first negative play he's had that I can remember in the football game. He's been really durable and dependable today on the road.
Jordan Williams, the linebacker, off the field for ECU for at least a snap. And for Hood, getting 18 carries at running back. He came in with only 26
for the season.
On the year, so
That's
he may well meet his season total by the time this game is over. Still a third down, though. Third and six for Temple. Marcy goes for right. He's got a first down. Cuts it back toward midfield.
Pass complete to number 13, Isaiah Wright.
And they've got it now into ECU territory. Gain of 17 when they only needed six.
And, Mike, that's entirely too easy. And that's got to be the focus for head coach Scotty Montgomery in trying to fix the defensive side of the football. They tried to play a number of players on that side of the football, and they're still down 34-10 with just under 11 minutes to go.
Nice block there to seal off the hole for Rich Rivato. Kenny Yeboah, the tight end, getting involved. So the defense continues to be a work in progress for ECU. Kenwick Thompson, the defensive coordinator, was reassigned after 2 weeks. Robert Prunty, who came over from Cincinnati in the offseason, was then assigned to be the defensive coordinator. But the yards and the penalties have continued to pile up today. And here's another injured player
it looks like
for ECU.
Tim Irvin down for the Pirates.
And part of what you just talked about as well, what the strategy for ECU may unintentionally come into effect here, is having to get younger, less experienced guys onto the field in place of guys like Irvin, or like we just saw, Jordan Williams come off the field, because those are guys that Scotty Montgomery said are playing, in some cases, in excess of 65, 70 snaps a game, and that's just too much over the course of the year.
And it doesn't matter your experience level, you're going to get worn down and you're going to be exposed if you're playing 70-plus plays a game.
Rich Rivato delving deeper into Pirate territory, where the Owls have spent most of their day, as a matter of fact, in Pirate waters. And they've come away successful, 33 of their 67 plays in plus territory.
And they've done a better job as the game went along of taking advantage of that field position and finishing in the red zone with touchdowns.
Another injured player, this time for Temple. The left tackle, Leon Johnson. It's another guy who wants to get into broadcasting.
Everybody's trying to get into broadcasting.
We told you about his teammate Jacob Martin on the defensive side. Johnson's interned with CSN Philadelphia there, which airs a lot of local sports.
That away, Leon.
They converted third and six with a gain of 17 on their last third down. Now it's third and five with the clock moving inside of 10 minutes. Marshy throws it to the flat. And a cutback is not enough to pick up the first down for Randall Jones. Clock continues to go as it's fourth down, Temple.
So ECU gets a stop on third down, brings on the Temple punting unit. My question is, what can Thomas Sark and the offense for the Pirates get going with 9:15 and counting in this football game?
That took an ECU bounce out to the 12-yard line after the kick. 8:48, fourth quarter, ECU football. Just 25 minutes or so away from kick between the Hurricanes and the Seminoles on ESPN. Looking for a big day from Mark Walton.
Walton injured that ankle last week against Duke in a victory. He should play today and be a big factor in the offense.
Thomas Sark unloads down the sideline in and out of the hands of Davon Grayson. Just trying to make an impact play on first down, spark the offense. There's still a lot of time on the clock. A comeback would be difficult, but not impossible for ECU.
And why not? Take a shot down the field. They've had success going up with their athletes on the outside. This time, Grayson doesn't come down with the football, but you kind of go right back to that on second down. Get it out to your outside receivers.
Under a four-man rush, the throw is to Johnson along the sideline, and it's snared by Crump, but he had stepped out of bounds in the act of making the catch, nearly an interception.
The defender's out of bounds. Third down.
Crump has been around the football for the Owls defense the entire afternoon. This time he tips it to himself, but as you can see, the left foot clearly out of bounds when he possessed the football. So third and 10 for the Pirates at the 11-yard line coming up.
Sark gets forced out of the pocket, rolling and throwing, and completes the pass, Trayvon Brown.
What a good throw on third down when you need to convert and you need to stay on the field. Thomas Sark comes through for the Pirates, finding Brown on the Temple Owl sideline. Subtly moving to his right, feels the pressure in the pocket, and throws a strike between two defenders.
Small window there to find Brown, who couldn't play last year because he was academically ineligible. Top two wide receivers this year for ECU. Neither was on the field last year, either because of injury or academics. Two flags come in at the 15-yard line with Sark getting swallowed up.
Holding offense. Number 78. Tony's decline. Second down.
Temple's been able to create pressure in the pocket most of the afternoon by just sending four. They've done a nice job. Martin and Finch and some of the linebackers that have added a fifth at times have done a nice job.
Sark pitches it out. Darius Penix turns it up to the 24-yard line. And that was Temple's goal this week, was not necessarily to create new defensive formations, but just to pick up different blitzes from the same base formation and be able to adapt to whatever it was that ECU was doing on offense. Sark pressured again, and he goes backwards, taken down at the 15-yard line. Fourth sack of the day. Jacob Martin getting into the mix again.
This is a team that came into the game with 15 sacks. Now make it 19 total for the Temple defense. And just winning on the edge, that speed and strength by Jacob Martin.
That was a short trip backwards for Sirk, who made the 108-mile journey from Durham to Greenville as the transfer from Duke to ECU. A lot of room on the return here. Isaiah Wright out to the 47-yard line. This may be, if Temple can keep things going here, one possession territory to try and wind out the clock for the end of this game. And the Owls will pick up their first conference win of the season and improve to 3-3.
This is the position head coach Jeff Collins wanted to be in the fourth quarter. The ability to keep your offense on the field, run the football, win up front, and close the game out.
It was a challenging start to their conference schedule as well, having to go against the top 25 team in USF and then take on Houston in week two. Hood across midfield. Gains about five.
5 yards to the 51, makes that be 49.
New quarterback as well is Frank Neutile, a redshirt junior from Wayne, New Jersey. Comes from a very powerful high school program as well at a Don Bosco Prep in Ramsey, New Jersey. The last time he saw the field was a couple weeks ago in that game against USF when they played three quarterbacks. But Marshy has helped bring them stability from that spot over the last several games.
He has, and so is this guy, David Hood. Over 100 yards, over 5 yards per touch. He's been effective, and Logan Marshy did a nice job of taking advantage of opportunities that Hood may have limped off the field with 5:17 left to go.
On the rollout, a high throw is pulled in. There is a flag down, though. The pass goes to Brandon Mack, which, as it stands now, would be his first catch of the year.
Holding defense. Penalty is declined. Just the play, first down.
Big step forward today, too, for Logan Marshy and just what he's been able to do. The last couple weeks, 23 out of 54, one touchdown, six interceptions. Today, 19 of 31, 321 yards, two scores, one pick.
And Mike, remember, it could have went downhill after the first interception in this game. This is a guy that bounced back. He had some help from Hood in the running game, but he was able to bounce back and gain confidence as the game moved along. And I think that that's going to be one of the attributes that takes this Temple offense from the level that they're at now and get them to compete against teams like South Florida and Central Florida and be in games as the season moves along.
And for them next weekend, they take on UConn as well. That's another game that Temple, I think, going into it, will expect to come out as a winner.
Yes, they should. This team should gain a whole lot of confidence. Forget about the opponent. Forget about the yards that East Carolina on defense has been able to give up. Look at yourself offensively when you grade this tape, and how have you improved at each position? You can go to running back. You can go to fullback. You can go to quarterback. The wide receivers have done a great job. Kirkwood with some spectacular catches on the outside.
Back to 100% health.
That's
as
right.
Well.
And I think head coach Jeff Collins will focus in on his team and what they've done well coming out of this one.
They've also evolved into a bit more of an offensive philosophy that suits them rather than what was inherited by Dave Patenew, because he said over the first 3 weeks he probably was a little bit more back and tight end heavy, more than he would like to be given his personnel set. Pass complete toward the sideline for Freddie Johnson, his second catch of the year, the freshman out of Miami Beach, Florida.
I think you're right. I think you always have to mold your offense into the talent that you have. You can come in with a concept or you can adopt a concept, but if it doesn't fit the identification of what you have talent-wise for this particular year, you have to have the flexibility to change and change on the fly. And I think that's what they've done with getting into more spread type of formations and getting more players in the passing game involved. And I think quarterback, running back, they found their answers.
And the goal, as it was on that play, no matter what the formation, was just to line up and run downhill.
Stay in bounds, with keep that clock going, and get the fullbacks a lot of touches as we wind this game down.
2:15 in the fourth quarter. And to think that Temple was down 3-0 in this game and what it has become from the start after they rattled off 24 second quarter points. So relatively speaking, a lower scoring second half, but that's the way Temple wanted it with the lead.
And Temple really didn't do much in the red zone to capitalize on their early opportunities and kept East Carolina in the football game until they were able to get a couple explosive plays, some stops on defense, and turn this score in their favor.
I don't necessarily mean to say this in a hopeless way, but it's not as though this performance by the ECU defense was inspiring this week, and the numbers were some of the worst in the country coming into this game. I think it's hard to build on what they've done over the first few weeks of the season.
They will continue to rotate and play more players, especially on the defensive side of the football. If you're healthy, you're going to get an opportunity to prove your worth as the season continues on.
Because really, what other option is there? If part A didn't work,
it's well, plan B and right. C and D right now, yes.
Somebody else has got to step in and get that chance. Now less than a minute to go. Temple's trying to seal things away. First and goal of the 6. The ECU defense has gotten a heavy dose of Rob Ritrovato, the fullback on this drive. He gets shouldered down at the 4-yard line. Oklahoma, Iowa State right now, a 7-point game. Whoa. But teams 2, 3, 4, and 5 all in action.
Right.
Here in the noon window. So Temple picks up the victory, and they snap a 2-game slide. The Owls improve to 3-3, 1-2 in conference play. ECU falls to 1-5. They're 1-2 in the American.
Impressive day for Logan Marshy. He was able to throw the football with efficiency. He found a running back in David Hood. Explosive plays, and the agony still continues on the other side for East Carolina and their defense, giving up 34 points today.
More questions than answers for the Pirates, who are now 1-5. Our production team today, led by Eric Postman, statistician Joe Sullivan, spotter Tim Swartz, my partner John Congemi. We thank you for being with us. Once again, Temple is a winner, 34-10 over ECU. Coming up next is ESPN Goal Line. Plenty more college football coming your way on ESPN Networks and on ABC tonight. Michigan and Michigan State at the Big House under the lights. It'll be a good one. We thank you for watching. I'm Mike Cousins saying so long from Dowdy Ficklin Stadium in Greenville, North Carolina. The wide side.